Sunset Call, a topic that's very relevant to a lot of singles these days. We're going to talk about love, courtship, marriage, and all that. And I know it's not February, but I also know that a lot of people want to learn this. So let's start with foundations. How many of you have ever seen or met or spoken with friends, relatives, loved ones who are going through emotional entanglements? Yes? Friends, not yourself. Okay. It's easy to reach out. Yeah, I know some people. All right. What are the usual concerns? What are the usual concerns? Does it have to do with situational things, or does it have to do with internal issues and questions? It's usually internal, right? So we're going to look at, this is going to be one of two parts. This is part one today. We're going to talk about the foundations. We're going to talk about biblical foundations of genders and gender roles and the history of some things. Now, many of this might be familiar to you, so we will run through it, the familiar ones, more quickly, but we will stick with the deeper parts of this, and we will kind of pitch our tent there, okay? So, let's not use this, because I don't know how to use it. Okay, so, first let's talk about man and woman in Genesis, just real quickly. Men and women are unique, agree? There's a difference between how men and women think, how men and women behave and relate to each other, women with women, men with men, and relate with the opposite sex, men and women, and vice versa. Now, let's take a look at first what Genesis says about man and woman. Genesis 2 verse 7 says, "The Lord God formed a man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being." So men, or man in general, came from dust, from the earth. "Then the Lord God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals." Why is this so important? Why did God be the one to name all the animals? Why did he give that job to Adam? Because to name something means to take ownership or stewardship over that thing. So because man was the one who was given the task to name all the other animals, God was implying that man should be a steward of all those animals. In the same way, you would never allow someone else to name your child. You name your child, right? And if someone gives a suggestion, you still have to be the one to say that I've decided to use your suggestion, but it's my decision. Because it's your child, obviously. Same principle. Then after that, Genesis chapter 2:21, "So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man." Notice, God did not say, "Man, sleep," and then God got from the ground also and then made the woman. He made the woman from the rib of the man. So it's unique in a sense that only woman will complement man. That's why we have men and women together, not men and women, not women and women, and not humans with animals. That's a very basic, general, like we just know it to be true, okay? Now, the reason also why it comes from the woman comes from the rib of man is because of the complementary nature of men and women. Men and women are supposed to complement one another, and I'm sure you know that in many different ways. In fact, Google will have so many memes or memes about that, right? Like men without women, and then you see a room and it's all practical, but not really very pretty. And then the woman comes along and suddenly what's practical becomes practical in a nice way. You know. And so there's so many different ways that men and women complement one another. And we need one another so that we can grow and be sanctified and get to know God through men and women interacting in a godly, biblical way. There's just a problem. Okay? So yeah, we'll go through this. So what's the purpose? The purpose of man came from dust to remind him of his purpose, which is stewardship. Woman came from the man to remind her of her purpose, which is to support the man. Okay? Now, if we go back to Genesis 2 here, okay? When man gave names to all the livestock on the earth, the man gave names to all of them, the birds and the sky, but for Adam, no suitable helper was found. Okay? It's not just a partner, but a helper, someone who would help the man in his call. If the man is to be a steward, the woman is to help the man in being a steward. And that's not a negative thing. That does not make the woman any less value or worth. It's just different roles, right? So, because of this, everything would have been great. The problem is, something bad happens. Genesis chapter 3. Okay, so the fall. We're familiar with this already. The serpent was more crafty. Basically, the serpent said, did God really say you should not eat of the fruit? Okay, so what happens is, the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom. She took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her. And he ate. So don't have this picture of Eve eating of the fruit and the man is nowhere to be found. The man was right there. So when the serpent talked to the woman, the man said nothing. He just allowed the serpent to talk. Go ahead, yeah. And then the serpent started lying. The man knew the serpent was lying, still said nothing. Did not expose falsehood, did not expose error. Just, okay, well, yeah, he's spreading falsehood to my wife. I guess this isn't going to go well. He doesn't step in. And so the woman eats, but in the end, who does God blame?
The man.
The man, right? So the Lord God called to the man, where are you? He answered, I heard you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree? So basically, this is not God not knowing anything, okay? This is God pointing something out. And then, listen to his answer. The man said, the woman! Here comes the blame game. But look at who he's blaming. The woman that you put here with me. He's blaming the woman and he's blaming God. She gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. And the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? The woman said, the serpent! So there's blame game. And that's usually what happens when sin is involved. Right? We don't want to accept it. We don't want to take responsibility. We point. So, what are the curses? We're familiar with this, but we need to go through it because the curses in Genesis will explain why the world is so messed up now. Okay? So, to Adam he said, because you listened to your wife, it's not because you ate. It's because you listened to your wife and ate from. Okay, so the first sin was not the eating of the tree, of the fruit of the tree. The first sin really was when he abdicated his role as a steward. He no longer took responsibility for his role as steward, but he allowed himself to say, hands off, okay, you do it, wife. That was the first sin. And because of that, curses the ground because of you, through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and dust you will return. Man was made from earth, dust, produce, harvest. And so the curse, he was supposed to be a steward of that. Now what he was a steward of, he's cursed by. You see that? Okay. With a woman. To the woman he said, I will make your pains in childbearing very severe. With painful labor you will give birth to children. Your desire will be for your husband and he will rule over you. What was the purpose of the woman? It was to help the man. But because of the sin and because of the fall, now the one thing she was a steward of, which was the man, is now cursed by it or through it. You know this? For the man, dust, you're steward of dust or earth, the earth will give you pains. The woman was a steward for man, now man will give you pains. And so, what happened with The man is always very difficult to produce, to provide, to make sure that you have a living to support your family. For the woman, that is the problem. Right? You look at all the Cosmo magazines, you look at all these, and I intentionally chose this picture. Because look at what they're trying to teach the women. Try to flatter the guy, try to do this to win the guy. Do all these different things so that you will get the guy. But in the end, doesn't this magazine or doesn't these ideologies further enslave women instead of giving them freedom and liberty and fulfillment? It enslaves them even more. Right? So it's ironic. That's how the world works now because of the fall. Now let's look at the development of the gender norms just real quickly. So 1958, Playboy began. Okay, and this is a huge thing. Why? Because it was because of Playboy in the first place that this whole ideology begins, that men are supposed to look at women like objects, etc. Or it was, if social media is the problem now, Playboy was the social media back then. Okay? And 1960s, the sexual revolution takes place. Sexual revolution is the whole flower power, Scooby-Doo. You're familiar with that, right? Make love, not war. And so people would get high and just sleep around. And, you know, the whole peace thing. But peace in the context of sexual immorality, fornication, and all that. And because this generation grew up and became parents themselves, the sexually liberated, and I use that word in a secular way, okay? These sexually liberated generation became parents and they raised their children accordingly. So the values that they had were passed on. And it was passed on, so during the 1987, the Christians, the church, responded or reacted with true love waits. And I'm sure you're familiar with this movement. You have the promise ring, I will not do anything, I will make sure I will stay pure and chaste, da 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 da. It was a response to the culture, you know, and it was a good effort. Yes, the intentions were good, but it had the opposite result. Because today, True Love Waits have these seminars, and all they say is, you know, it's a scare thing, it's a scare tactic. Oh, if you do this, you're going to have AIDS, or you're going to, you know, how many people die of STDs, and you know, all those. It's more of fear, not of faith. It's more about the consequences of sin. Worldly consequences of sin more than the grace of God that's supposed to transform. That's what happened. But it is what it is. 2000s, internet makes most postmodernism values spread. When it was just confined to certain places before, now it's all over the world. Google alone will tell you that you just make a search, everything comes out, no? So relativism and emotionalism replaced critical thought. Instead of people thinking about right and wrong, morality, what to do, what not to do, people are now valuing feelings. If you feel it, it must be right. If it makes you feel good, then it must be good. That's why we have those lines in those songs that says, how can something that feels so right be so wrong? Have you heard that? You know? So, you know, those kinds of songs. And then, that's 2017, things shifted. Instead of emotionalism, now it's over spiritualization. But really, it's still just emotionalism, but with a new spiritual packaging. Instead of saying, I feel that this is right, they say, God told me this is right. Right? But it's the same problem. Okay, so, what happened, or what's the net effect? Well, the world turns people into puppets. First, emotions are manipulated, hearts are defrauded to win the affections. That's usually how dating works, you agree? There's people who defraud one another, you put your best foot forward, you try to seduce, manipulate, play the game. And I'm sure you've heard of things like speed dating, all these new innovations you go through online and then you make a scientific, quote-unquote, scientific study. They look at your hobbies, interest, likes, dislikes. Oh, you're a match. And they do those kinds of things, but it doesn't really work. So hearts are defrauded to win the affections. One, dating has become a form of sport, conquest, or hobby. I was talking to a friend of mine who's from the United States, and he told me in the United States, having a date on a Friday night is normal. Even if you don't like someone, you're supposed to have a date on a Friday night. If you don't have a date on Friday night, you're a loser. I'm like, seriously, bro? So how did you handle it? He said, well, I was young and stupid, so I dated Christians Friday nights. And what happened? Pretty much nothing. You know, I just spent money. So that's usually what happens. Dating has become a form of sport or conquest. You try to win the girl, you try to get the girl. And just like in Disney and Aladdin, Jasmine says to Aladdin, I am not surprised to be won.
Yeah.
All the Disney fans are like, I can show you the world in the map. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Next, people rely on psychology, physiology, biology, hormones, hypnotism, and other tactics to use on one another. Have you ever seen those videos online where a guy who's a professional hypnotist learns how to manipulate women? Yeah? And then there are certain words that you, when you say, put together in a sentence, it subconsciously communicates to the girl that you're good for each other. Things like that, it's really dumb. If you don't believe me, just go on YouTube and search there, subconscious hypnotism, pick up girls. It's like, whoa, there's a lot of that online today. It's really stupid. What else? So that's psychology, physiology, biology, hormones, you know, like, and some of you, I've talked to some of the people here, and you know, they talk about like relying on the dopamine of the brain, you know, make a girl, compliment a girl so she'll feel happy, and the brain secretes dopamine, and she'll be all elated and happy, oh, and then you intentionally, purposefully step back, so now the girl is looking for that dopamine, so she will subconsciously look for you. That's, I'm sorry, but if that's what you're thinking, you're manipulative.
Yeah.
And it doesn't work. Okay? It doesn't work. And that's wrong. And this is you using someone else to get to your desired results. Next. Sex and sexuality, along with sensuality and pragmatism, has become the standard for social and relational health. Have you ever heard, and let's just be mature about this, okay? Sex and sexuality is a very huge $1 trillion industry. And so, people use this as a means to make profit. But, if you say, hey, we're gonna sell sex and sexuality to make money, you're gonna say, well, I don't wanna buy that. But if they say, no, no, it's for your own good, so you'll get into a relationship. People say, oh, I'll buy that then. And that's the problem. Sensuality, pragmatism, you know, it's the whole, you should sleep with a guy so that he will continue to look for you. Or don't sleep with a guy so that you won't feel cheap. So which is it? It's confusing. And it's confusing because there are no real standards. It's all emotionalism, it's all pragmatism. It's, will that work for him? Maybe it will work for me. And then if it doesn't work for me, I gotta try something else. Still won't work. Why? Again, because the standards are not biblical. God was the one who made man and woman, therefore, God is the one who knows what's best. If we don't follow God's standards or God's word, we will always feel lost. Next, love is defined as a drug or a mere fleeting emotion. If you feel love, then you must love. If you don't feel it anymore, then divorce. Isn't that the case? Most of the time. And then people say things like, well, I don't feel that the relationship is beneficial for us anymore. And then you ask them to define, what made you feel that? And most psychiatrists will always ask the question, how did it make you feel? After the 10th session, they're still asking you how it made you feel. You'll just be self-aware of your very fleeting emotions, but there's no real solution. And the whole time, the person's making money. When God's word is right there, it's in the national bookstore for 150 pesos. Right? All it takes is the desire to get to know God. So, love is defined as a drug or a fleeting emotion. Commitments are feared or idolized. Right? A lot of men are so afraid of commitments because they feel that if they enter into something good, they might miss out on something better. So, I'll just get what I can from one relationship, benefit from this, and then after a while, if there's something better that comes along, goodbye to you, go to the next. Some idolize commitments. You know, as long as someone commits to me, then I feel so accepted. Notice the operative word. I feel accepted. I feel significant. It feels great to be the center of someone else's world. And in the end, it's frustration. So people end up falling in love with fake versions of themselves and fake versions of one another. You agree? That's the end result. When you manipulate, you play the game, you pretend to be someone you're not, then that's the end result. You try to be someone you're not, and then when you're in a relationship, they'll say, you've changed. You know, the real answer to that is, I never changed. I was putting on a mask the whole time we were dating. Here's the real me. Right? That's the effect. So, the result? Number one, people throw their heart out on a line. They want to fish. They want to be with someone, but heartbreak. Oh. Next, Facebook understands this all too well, so there's your option. What's your relationship? It's complicated. You know, MU, malabong usapan. In English, it's a weird thing that we have. Okay? And of course, here. People don't know the roles anymore, so they'll say things like, I want equality, but I also want special treatment. So what is it really? No? Confusing. Wouldn't you agree? Okay. So, the result is excess baggage. What do I mean? And that's the picture because many times excess baggages are a result of relational issues in your past. Let's take a look at a few. People have emotional and relational wounds that heal improperly or do not heal at all. There's trauma. Diba? You know, I got hurt by this guy before, so all men are evil. And so when someone tries to sincerely show honor, respect, love, and biblical, healthy, biblical, godly friendship, the person will say, this person must want something. You evil, wicked thing. Right? How very traumatized. No? Or if a guy gets hurt by a girl, I got rejected. I will never get rejected again. So you know what he does? He never commits. He never makes himself vulnerable. He will manipulate the heart of the girl he likes until finally the girl's 99% sure. And he wants to be 99% sure so he can finally just say, and he doesn't even say, I like you. It's, what do you think about us? And I'm like, dude, you're the guy. Oh my goodness, it's supposed to be your role to address this. Right? So, that's one. Another one, parents teach the wrong things to their children or provide harmful examples. And this is very sad. Can you imagine when growing up, you talk to your dad, you're a guy, you talk to your dad, hey dad, what does it mean to like a girl? And then the dad says, well, when I like your mom, the trick, son, is to play the game. And you already know you're in trouble when your dad talks that way. Can you imagine when your mom tells you and tells a daughter, daughter, you like this guy? Yes? Then you should wear something pretty or something sexy. The moment the mom allows that, when mothers allow their daughters to dress, sorry for the word, to dress more like prostitutes than ladies, you know there's a problem. You know there's a problem. So parents provide harmful examples or teach the wrong thing. Another result, broken families or dysfunctional families that coexist in unhealthy ways. And it's a tough generation we live in. We have single dads, we have single moms, we have orphans who are left and abandoned. It's very, very confusing. And when this happens, they only learn how to cope one way. If you don't have a church, if you don't have a church that's healthy, that teaches you these things growing up, and you don't have people who support you emotionally and teach you theologically, all you cling on to is what you've learned from the past. And that's how you cope. And because that's the only way you know how to cope, you think that it's normal. So you won't even hope for something better. And that's a sad thing. So we need to make sure that we always engage the thoughts of people and talk about these things. No? Next, the very definitions of love, marriage, romance, and healthy relationships are twisted to their own detriment. One of my favorite poets is, believe it or not, Shakespeare. And then he defines love in a very poetic way. Love is a few vexed with a thousand sighs or something like that. So love is a fume. Wow, he just described perfectly how the world defines love. It's a fume, it just disappears. It's not love. When you define marriage, people say, what is marriage? Marriage is when you're lonely and you need someone to be with. That's not marriage. That's not the purpose of marriage, right? Or people say, how about this? What is romance? Romance is when you feel it in your heart. So your heart is deceitful and feelings are fleeting. That's how you're in trouble if that's your definition. How about this? The definition of healthy relationships. Healthy relationships is when we accept one another. That's why we're living together now. We're not married. So that we can truly feel the love and accept one another wholeheartedly. And from there we will see if we're really for each other. Is that healthy? That is this. Okay? But is it true? It's not true, but it's reality, right? That's the world we live in today. So, let's look at how the Bible defines things, okay? First, love is not a happening. Happenings are not dependable and feelings are fickle. If Jesus relied on feelings, I don't think he'd go to the cross. Imagine Jesus saying, Father, I don't feel the pain right now, you know, like the nail, the rust, and my hands getting itchy because of the rust of the nail. Okay, angels, just kill them all. And we're all dead. Can you picture that? It's over. Feelings are not dependable. Happenings are just that. They're just happenings. Next. Oh, one more thing. When we upload this, I'm going to upload a PDF file for you guys. So if you write notes, it's better to write your insights more than copying what's really there. Because you can get that. We'll provide it for you. Next, we have to contrast 1 Corinthians 13, love never fails, versus the love that is defined by the world. The world defines love as something that can fail. Right? That's why there's hashtag wala forever. No? But the truth is, love never fails. If it's true love, it doesn't fail. Imagine if love fails. Jesus says, for God so loved the world, but then God's love failed? Apatay ta. We're doomed. Feelings are important, yes, but feelings follow. Feelings are the result. They're not the cause. Jesus first commits to love sinners like you and me, and because he commits to love, he decides to love early on, the feelings follow. Now, think about this for a moment. We live in an age where we don't do matchmaking or, you know, when families chose who their kids would marry. But how come in the old days the parents chose who their kids would marry and the marriages would still work out? Because they had a strong understanding of commitment. And the love, the feeling of love still follows. I'm not saying we're going to matchmake people here. I'm not, okay? We don't agree with that. But you have to admit that during those days, people used that because it would still work if the understanding of love is on the basis of commitment. Not emotions. Love is commanded, therefore it's controllable. So, for every married person who says, I couldn't help it, I just had feelings for this other person who's not my spouse. I couldn't control myself. That's not true. If love is a command, then you can control love. It's not an uncontrollable force. Okay? Love is not conditional on the spouse's behavior or the other person's behavior. If the love of Christ is conditioned on our behavior, we'd all be rejected, but immediately. Huh? So it's not conditional on the spouse's behavior. So spouses or people or relationships or couples who say we don't love each other anymore must therefore repent. Especially if the people are married and they say, oh, we'll just end the marriage. Why? Because we don't love each other anymore. We don't feel love for one another anymore. The answer to that, biblically, repent of being unloving, repent of unforgiveness, repent of bitterness, because I'm sure there's going to be fights there. Repent of all those excess baggages, turn back to God, go back to the gospel, and if you both repent, you will see the grace of God work. But there must be repentance from both sides. Okay, so repentance is the answer. So, the world also says, test drive your partner before marriage. The problem is we're not objects, we're not cars. We're people. And that's usually what happens. You live together for a moment so you can test drive. You want to see if you're really complementary or compatible. So they live together first and all that. How do I know if we're compatible sexually? I'm like, dude, that's not even the question you're supposed to be asking right now. Okay, so things like that. The Bible goes against that and says we are people. The problem with a lot of times is this. We're supposed to love people and use things. The world uses people for the things that they love. So people have become objects. Okay? So, the world versus the word. So, let's go back to the Bible. What is the purpose of romance? The answer is right there. Marriage. And I know we're talking about courtship and friendship now, but we're going to go to the future first and then we're going to look work back, okay? Because what's the point of learning how to drive if we don't know where we're headed, right? We have to look at the purpose first. So we go back to the Bible. The purpose of romance is marriage, Genesis 2:24. That is when a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. The whole purpose of romance is to get married, not to get butterflies in your stomach, not to feel the kilig. It's not to have something to post on Facebook, okay, or Instagram, but it's to be married. So, the first question I would ask men, if you're pursuing women, is this. Are you ready to get married now? I'm not asking if you want to get married, maybe later on, somewhere in the future, of course, everyone wants to get married. No. Are you ready to get married now? Right now? Okay? That's the question. We'll get to that more in a bit. Marriage is supposed to reflect and embody the glory of God. Okay? Hear that clearly. Marriage is supposed to reflect and embody the glory of God. Not, you know, I'm such a good husband because my wife is blooming, or I'm such a good wife because look at my husband. He's flourishing in God's call in his life. It's not about that. Both parties are sinners. You get one sinner, you get another sinner, you put them together, and guess what you get? More sin. Okay? And then after a while, you get baby sinners, but they're still sinners. And then you've got a household full of sinners. So the whole point of marriage is to reflect the glory of God because of the gospel, because of the cross, and we reflect that when we, as the sermon earlier said, when we abide in Christ, and the grace of God prunes not just the two of you as individuals, but your marriage.
Amen.
Okay? Next. The purpose of marriage is by incarnating the love of Christ for his bride, the church. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. That's quite clear, but we'll expand on that a little bit more. But by incarnating the love of Christ for his bride. Mark Dever says it this way. The church is the gospel made visible. In this context, marriage is supposed to make the gospel visible. You know, when you get married, please do not assume that everything will be rainbows and candies. That's not true, okay? When you watch Hollywood, and then it says they end up getting married and then the end, that's not the end. They should show movies where marriages are going through the real deal, the real things. They fight, they get angry, they disappoint one another, frustrate one another, there are times they want to kill one another. No, so, I mean, it's like that. But when they fight, there has to be this reconciliatory attitude because of the grace that they receive from Jesus Christ. Okay? Next. Husbands and wives, live out gospel truths to display the person and work of Jesus Christ. And this is what is the most painful things you will experience as a married person later on. When, for example, your spouse sins against you and you say, I don't want to ask for forgiveness, I don't want to say sorry, because if I say sorry, that means the person won. And then we think of the gospel where the Bible says, while we were yet sinners, God loved us. So I'm thinking, oh man, if I have to display gospel truths, if I want to have a gospel-centered marriage, it means I need to get all the gospel principles, the gospel truths, and apply them in my marriage, then it'll work out. So even if I don't want to ask for forgiveness, I must initiate reconciliation. So if you want a commitment, this is where you're supposed to be headed. We must be conscious. Our minds should be aware of these things. Okay? So look at the rows. I'm going to read it straight. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. So it is sacrificial. That he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. Which means if you're a man and you want to get married, guess what? Once you guys get married, let's say you're a guy here, you're pursuing a girl here in church. Once you get married, we will not be the pastors of your wives. If you're the man, you are the pastor of your wife. It just so happens that you both come to NCC when you're the pastor of your wife. Is that clear? So, if you want to get married, are you ready to pastor a family? Not to be a husband. Not to get the benefits of a husband. Are you ready to pastor a family? That's the question. How do you do that? With the washing of water with the word. The primary responsibility to teach the women in the home is the husband's. It is his job to read the Bible and to explain and to teach the Bible to the family. When they go to church on Sunday, that should just be appetizer. The main course, the spiritual feeding, should be from the home. Okay? Next. Until when? So that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So, when you think of getting married, here's me personally, here's what I'm thinking. One day, I'm going to go to Jesus Christ and I will present my wife, Rainey, to the Lord. And I will say, Lord, Master, here's your daughter. You gave her to me temporarily on earth. I hope as I present her back to you, she's pleasing to you. That should be in your head. And that's scary, that's dangerous, but it's challenging and exciting. But I have to remember that she's not my wife, really. Ultimately, yes, she's my wife, but ultimately, she's a bride of Christ, as am I. So I have to think that way. Because verse 28 says so, in the same way, that phrase, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. As I am pursuing sanctification for myself, I need to pursue that for my spouse. And then he says, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church. There we go again. Christ died for the church. Husbands, die for your wives. Not literally, of course, but like what Leonard said, pick up the socks, put them in the hamper, or, you know, learn, pursue sanctification. Because we are members of his body, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. And then verse 32, this mystery is profound. And I'm saying that it refers to Christ and the church. So that's the gospel. Jesus and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. So, there are gospel truths that have to be in the marriage. We apply those gospel truths in the marriage and it will go fine. It will go well on both parties. Look at the wives. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. There's a key. As to the Lord. Submission does not... Okay, let me just clarify it, okay? People say, well, if he says something and I disagree, you mean to say I should still submit? The answer, as long as it's not sinful, yes, you're supposed to submit. Because if you both agree, that's not called submission. It's called agreement. Submission is when you disagree, but then I say, if you're a lady here and you're a very strong, independent woman and all of that, and you like the whole Beyonce thing, girl power stuff, all right, okay. Now think of it this way. Do you truly believe that the Holy Spirit is working in your husband's life? Do you trust that your husband is running after Jesus Christ? If the answer is yes, and he makes a decision, and it's not something you agree with, but it's not sinful, okay? Please submit. Talk to him, yes. Give him your thoughts, yes. Discuss. But in the end, if he says, this is it, then that's it. Because he's supposed to be the one leading you. there might be something that God is showing him that he hasn't, that God is not showing you, and God wants you to learn how to submit well. Or God might be teaching your husband what it's like to not really go to the word, and when he makes a wrong decision, and you, submission doesn't mean I fully support what you want to do, rah rah rah. It's I disagree with this, but because you want to do it, I'll support in my own way, in such a way that my conscience is not, I don't violate my own conscience. But if and when his plans go nuts, please don't go to your husband and say, see, I told you so, next time you listen to me, huh? Wala na, you're switching roles, right? When his plans fall, he's already down. Wives, don't kick the husband when he's down. Instead, encourage him, hon, I still love you, I still submit to you, I still recognize Christ's authority in you, and I still see Christ being formed in you, and I recognize your authority in my life. And then, you work on it together again. That's marriage. And I'm talking a lot about marriage right now, and I know you guys are single, but like, we're talking about marriage, I'm thinking of courtship, you know? Because that's where it's supposed to be heading. Okay? John Piper says it this way. You ought to marry someone who's willing to go anywhere for God. If they're not, then they're out. And I like that mindset. Okay, so it has to be God. So submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. Of course, if your husband wants to sin, then you can't do that. If your husband says, hon, I want to provide for you, so I'll rob a bank, you'll drive the getaway car. Like, that's not how it works. And you say no. If it's not sinful, then yes, you discuss and submit, okay? So, let's go to the friendship. We talked about marriage. What's the foundation? Friendship. Friendship, the foundation of marriage is healthy biblical friendships. That's why a lot of marriages fail today, because they jump straight into the relationship without a good friendship as a biblical solid foundation. You go somewhere, you like a girl without having friendship yet. I just want to, you know, feel all the emotions. And so you go through courtship, oh, we're already dating, haha! And then when you get married, I don't really know her. She doesn't really know me. And so many problems arise, so many fights. So the foundation is a good biblical friendship. Let's look at biblical friendships. And John 15, again. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this. Someone lay down his life for his friends. This is our sermon today. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father I have made known to you. Just this text alone, we're not going to actually do so much, but here are some observations. One, friendship is a command. It's a command. This is my commandment, that you love one another. This good, healthy, biblical friendship based on love is a command. Secondly, it is Christ-like, as I have loved you. So good biblical friendships is being Christ-like with one another here in this context. You're singles, you're single men, single women, are you Christ-like to one another? Okay? Next, it is selfless. You have to think more of the other person than of yourself when it comes to biblical friendships. Are you thinking about how she makes me feel or how I can help her grow? Am I thinking more about the ulalas that I get? Or am I thinking more about how this person can become more and more like Christ? Am I serving this person the way Christ is serving the church? Okay? It is genuine. There's no manipulation, there's no pretension. If your intention is friendship, then be clear. If your intention is more than friendship, it has to be clear. There cannot be any, just don't make it confusing. We'll get to that in a bit. And it is God-worthy. You're always thinking of how God would look upon your friendships. Does this please the Father? In the way I'm acting towards this person, that person, this person, that person, is it pleasing to the Father? Or is it pleasing to me? And many times, we go for what's pleasing to ourselves. And that's dangerous. So let's be careful. Now, I'm sure you're all thinking, oh my goodness, this is harder than I thought. Well, there's grace. When you abide in Christ, remember that, when you abide in Christ, the Holy Spirit will help you bear fruit. Our job is not to produce fruit. It's like, there's no fruit. Okay, you don't do that. Let the Holy Spirit do it. You're like, popping out. That's not how it works. Alright? Next. Alright. Colossians. Okay, let's look at Colossians before you get distracted by the fruit-bearing thing. Okay. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, etc., etc. So, if you just go through that, a few more observations. First, it is cross-carrying. All these things are earthly, sexual immorality, impurity, covetousness, which is idolatry. These are the reasons why the wrath of God is coming. And Paul says, we did those before. When we were Christians, we lived that way. And Paul is saying, in these you too once walked when you were living in them, but now you must put them all away. Anger, wrath, violence, slander, obscene talk from your mouth. We have to carry our cross. We put them away for the sake of others. So if, and many times we don't like putting them away because we're used to them. Again, excess baggages. That's what we learn. We have to put those away. Next, it must be edifying. The conversations that fly out of our mouths. And there's a difference between light, fun, banter, and hardcore, non-stop, just not edifying talk anymore. So let's be careful with even our speech. It should be seasoned with salt. Our conversations have to be edifying. Of course, we're not saying every time we meet, it's all like, how are you? Oh, God is good. That's not what we're talking about, you know? Oh, are you thirsty? It's okay. I already had living water. You know? just be careful. We don't have to go to that level. But let's be conscious with our conversations. Okay? Next, do not lie to one another. You should be sincere. Okay? Don't lie to one another. Now, this isn't just in the context of confession of sin. This is not just in the context of how are you doing good, praise God. That's not it. Even in our friendships, in our relationships, there are many times this happens. Guy likes girl. Guy goes out with girl. Guy tells the girl, I just want friendship. And then the actions say a different story. Be careful with that. That's lying. Because you're communicating one thing with your mouth, another thing with your actions. Or the opposite. You're communicating the negative with your actions, but you're saying a lot with your words. We'll get to that more. We'll get to more of that later. It is also progressive. We're not saying that it will happen overnight. We're not saying, oh, the talk's done, so I look at all my friends in church, I'm single, they're all single, how do I live? So you start walking and you start saying things like, hi, am I edifying to you? Am I edifying to you? You know, are you doing your Bible? Am I reading? It's not like that. It doesn't happen overnight. It's progressive. So don't feel like, oh, I need to fix everything today. No. Okay? Because you'll go nuts, and then you'll fail, and then you'll get mad at yourself, and then you'll condemn yourself, and then you'll feel depressed. Alright? Don't say it will happen overnight, but go through the process of pruning, of abiding in Christ, and being pruned by God. He will do it. Okay? Next. It is fair. Okay? The Bible says here, there is no Greek and Jew, circumcised and circumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. So how we treat one another should be the same. If you're all friends with one another, then how you treat one another should be how you treat everyone else. There should be no favoritism. And that's where good, healthy, biblical friendships come in. When I was single, I had to make sure that how I treat one lady is how I treated all the ladies. If you're a guy, how you treat one girl is how you should treat all the girls. No special treatment. If you're a girl, how you treat one guy is how you should treat all the other guys. No special treatment. And I know that can be tough because some personalities are different, right? Like some of you have the same hobbies, you have the same likes, interests, and all that. So you tend to spend more time with one another because of conversations. That's fine. But in terms of treatment, in terms of how you regard one another, if it's you're really friends, then treat one another as friends, all the same. When you do that, then there's going to be no accusation of manipulation, defrauding, or false messages, all that. Right? You see how that can work? You see how it can be beneficial? Now we're going to talk about later on, what if I like a person? What am I supposed to do with all these emotions that are bottled up inside? You know, should I uncork the bottle? We're going to get there. But for now, this is the foundation. This is the foundation you should have. Because if you have a healthy, and remember, I'm using the words intentionally, godly, healthy, biblical friendships. It's godly, it's Godward, it's healthy, there's no manipulation. You're emotionally mature, you're secure. They're godly, they're healthy, and they're biblical. It has to be Bible-based, please. When you have that, then when you enter into the season of courtship, which we'll talk about later on, it will be a healthy courtship. There won't be excess baggage. The problem most of the time is, here's normally what happened. I'm not yet a Christian, so my mind in courtship and romance is all about the worldly style, okay? I become a Christian, so I know salvation is by grace through faith, but courtship is still by manipulation. Dating is still worldly. So I need to renew my mind in that area. And that's true for all areas of our lives. Some people, I'm now a Christian, but I do business like the world. I'm not a Christian, but I do courtship like the world. I'm not a Christian, but I do blank like the world, because the mind hasn't been renewed. That's why we have this talk. So learn to renew your mind in certain areas of your life. This is one of them. And so it starts with good biblical friendship. What happens when you don't have good biblical friendships, good, godly, healthy biblical friendships is this. I'm already a Christian. This other person is a Christian. My view of romance is worldly. This person's view of romance is still worldly. So, here I am worshiping God, but here we are defrauding one another, hurting one another, causing confusion with one another. And so I am causing the person to have excess baggage, and this person is causing me to have excess baggage. So when we enter into courtship, we have so much excess baggages after being saved. And that is more painful. Because when the rubber meets the road, and all these things come out, they say things like, I thought you were a Christian. And then they go, I thought I was a Christian. So it's confusing, all right? So learn as early as now. Okay. One more. Okay, Colossians chapter 3. We'll just continue this. Put on them as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another. Okay, so it's sacrificial. If one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. So it's forgiving. And that's what I meant. Many times, we cause one another to have excess baggage. So we're not going to be perfect in how we relate with one another as singles, because we live in a fallen world. Romans chapter 7, Paul says, the thing I don't want to do, I keep doing. The things I should do, I'm not doing. So we forgive one another, we sacrifice, we forgive one another. Next, it is also loving. Above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. You want peace in your friendships, in your relationships? Forgive and then love. We sacrifice, we forgive, we love. It is also sanctifying. Look what he says. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. So it is sanctifying. That's what we meant earlier, the speech in your mouth, from your mouth, should edify. You know, it should build up, it should encourage. Even when we correct one another, it should be in a building up kind of way, not a tearing down kind of way. There's a difference in how you be correct. Can you imagine if someone's wrong, and instead of, and the person says, I want to build him up because he's wrong in his beliefs, and then you go near, hey, you're wrong. Don't you read your Bible? Aren't you a Christian? That's not really correcting, that's condemning. A better way of saying it is, that's an interesting thought you have. Hey, what do you think about this verse of scripture? Take a look at this. How does that compare? And then sometimes we have to learn when to correct a person in public, when to correct a person in private, when to take the person aside, and when to... So we have to think of all these things. It's sanctifying, and it helps one another grow. and respectful. Whatever you do, in word or deed, word or deed, your conversations with your friendships, how you treat one another, how you honor one another as singles, be thankful. Okay? Do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. And I'm going to say this, and it's going to sound cheesy. When was the last time you thanked God for the people in church? When was the last time you said, thank you, Lord, for, and then fill in the blanks? Not just your crush, okay? Thank you, God, for so-and-so. Oh, my God. That's one thing. But when have you thanked God for the people in church? Because, you know, you see their value in their life. You see that they are following God, and you see God's grace in their life, and you say, Lord, I'm so encouraged by them, by their growth, by their obedience, by their love for you, by their love for the church. When the person prays, when the person reads scripture and shares stuff, even if it's a one line on Facebook, but that really encouraged me. Thank you for them. Yes, I say thank you, God, for using them, but thank you, God, for them. We should be thankful for one another. So that's good, godly, healthy, biblical friendships. Okay, so, warnings. So we talked a little bit about the foundations. Let's look at the warnings. Number one, please do not have this attitude to collect, select, then reject. Because people are not candidates or applicants for your heart. You know? And a lot of times, this is the mindset, and I tell you this, I don't know about other churches, we're not going to talk about that, but I'll tell you now, because we're speaking to NCC specifically, if any person, man or woman, has this mindset, we will correct that person and there will be a long talk with all the elders. If you have that mindset, collect, select. I like this. I like five people. I tried girl A, not interested, girl B, not interested, girl C. That's not how it works. If that's your mindset, be prepared. Okay? I tell you ahead of time. Why? Why? Why is this the wrong mindset? Here's why. Because Jesus Christ, when He went to the cross, He doesn't have this attitude. Collect. Well, this person is really disobedient, so never mind. This person is obedient, okay, fine. Jesus doesn't have that towards us. Okay? So we're supposed to have healthy friendships. If you see people as mere candidates, then you will never truly honor them as friends. Because the moment that they don't suit you or fancy you, you're done with them. So in a sense, you were emotionally using them for your own purposes still. Right? So be careful. Next, please do not flirt with the opposite sex. You are defrauding and manipulating them if you do. Now, I have no idea who this couple is. I'm sorry. I don't know who this couple is. I just went on Google and I said couple selfie and I just chose the first couple. And here's why. I use this as an example because I'm so afraid that people flirt even unknowingly. Here's what I mean. When you have couple selfies and you're not a couple, can I just say this? And I know you'll agree with me. When two people post a selfie and they're not together, what's the first thing in your mind? Right? Oi. Uy, bagay. Or, are they dating? Right? Now, if you do this, if you behave this way towards another single, okay, and everyone begins to think, and you have no intentions whatsoever, but everyone's thinking it, what will happen? Just reality. Okay, you're a guy, you take a selfie with a girl, hi, form the heart. Picture that, okay? Bam, selfie. What's going to happen? I tell you what's going to happen. All the girl's friends will start talking. Is he pursuing you? Is he dating you? Are you guys dating? Are you in courtship? And the girl's like, I don't know. And then you go home, maybe, bitaw no? And then the guy's just like, oh, it's a cool selfie. So this is very dangerous. It's the same for girls and guys. Sometimes the girl just wants to get the feels. I like the attention. And here's the guy pursuing her, and she's like, well, I didn't do anything, it was just a selfie. Oh, check your heart. Be careful with this, the whole flirting thing. Please, 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 please. Okay? Why do I do this? Now, guys, listen. I'm gonna give you some examples and they're specific. And a lot of times we've spoken about this. So if you know that this applies to you and you know that it's done, I'm using it merely as an example and nothing more, okay? Please understand that. Qualify it. If we have spoken about this issue already, then you know I'm not attacking you, but it's an example for everyone else to know. But this is a general principle. Please do not be childish with one another. Immaturity is not only unprofitable, but also dangerous. Sometimes we're playful to a fault. And being playful to a fault sometimes can be hurtful and can cause long-term issues. If it's not with the person you're playing with, it's to everyone else watching the two of you play. You hear me? Okay, so please be very careful. When I was not yet a Christian, I had some friends, and there was this one friend of mine who would borrow my phone and then change her name on my phone into something cute. And now, not for anything else, I'm OC, okay? So I hated when people do, and so I got kind of pissed, and she's like, why did you change the name? I changed it, and I'm like, that's not your name. You know, so it's just because I'm OC, but sometimes we do that. We borrow someone else's phone, and you know, my sister-in-law uses my phone to take selfies. And so I always just send a selfie to her, and then I just delete everything. You know, but be careful with that, because it can still send the wrong signals. Picture this for a moment. If I had pictures in my phone of a girl that's not raining, who took a selfie? Oh man, that's Leonard and Freddie will be meeting with me, you know, and I'll be like, oh, I swear, you know.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen there is Leonard and Freddie will talk to me first, and then they will hold Rainy back, you know, for my own safety and protection. All right, next. Here's one more. Please do not. You know what? I should have capitalized the not here. Please do not broadcast the identity of your crush to other singles. If you're single, please don't tell all the other singles who you like. Okay? Even if it's, I want to be, you know, I want to be transparent. Don't. In fact, just talk to either the elders or married people, not the other singles. You know why? You have no idea what if the guy you're talking to likes the same girl. What an issue that's gonna be. And that's gonna be a whole, well, is this, he said it first, so. Now picture this for a moment. Let's say I'm a single guy. Let's pretend I'm a single guy and I like Rainy. And someone else tells me that he also likes Rainy. So in my mind, should I court her right now? I should get into courtship with her first. Because, you know,
first move,
like I call dibs. No, or I'm gonna build a fence around her, you know, like start, like the moment, you know, I like Rainy. Oh, really? And then that night, hi Rainy, how are you doing? Panic mode. That's not how it works, okay? So don't tell one another who you like. Because for guys, it's different. For girls, it's different. Here's how. For guys, they will think this way. Have I lost my right to pursue her because my brother already said he likes her? Now, should I tell the guy, hey, what a coincidence! You know, that's confusing. Now for the girls. Yeah, that's really weird. And so now when you look at each other, there's tension between the two of you. You know, you look at each other like, my rival. It's not like that. The friendship just disappears. If you're two girls and you like the same guy, please don't say anything also to other singles. You know why? Because the moment a girl finds out, oh, she likes the same dude, the next thing you know, her makeup is times two. Goes to church, goes to the guy, hi! I'm not sure. It's war, it's cold war, you know? And so guys, just don't. Talk to the elders of the church, talk to the married people. And now, I tell you what, as elders, the three of us, we talk, okay? You guys already know this. We talk a lot. We talk a lot about you guys, not because of gossip. We talk about you so we know how to talk to you. All right, to give you counsel, give you advice. We talk about how we should treat one another so we can pray for you. So we know, okay? So just please avoid the awkwardness. Next, here's another one. Please do not use your personality as an excuse because we are to be sanctified, okay? Don't say, well, I'm naturally playful. Well, stop it. Learn and grow. Okay? I'm naturally, and I tell you, sometimes people say this. Okay, I'm gonna say something. I'm sorry, huh? But some people say it this way. Can I help it if I'm charming?
Oh!
What? And I kid you not, I actually heard a guy say it to me, not this church. Way, way back when, more than 10 years ago, a guy said, can I help it if I'm charming? My direct answer to him is, bro, you can. And then he goes, you mean to say I should just be boring? I said, no, I'm saying you should be pure. And then it was end of friendship from there. He was like, oh, baby, it's too straight. I'm like, I don't care what you think, you know? But, no. It's because many times, there's this whole, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Yeah, you're also a sinner, don't forget. You know? So, fearfully and wonderfully made, we should fear you. All right, next. So, guiding principles for friendship. Now, think of, what does this picture symbolize to you? What does this picture make you think? Huh?
Selfie.
Selfie. Okay, what else? Seriously.
Third party.
What?
Third.
Yes, a third party. And I put that there because here's the guiding principle. Treat others the way you would treat a married person. If you're single, treat other singles the same way you would treat a married person. Think of that for a moment. So all of you guys, here's the thing. All of you guys, treat the ladies the same way you would treat my wife. All of you girls, treat me the way you would treat Rainy. Right? Or treat the other men the same way you would treat me for Rainy's sake. Okay? Is that a good guiding principle?
Yes.
Yeah. Here's why. Would you date someone else's spouse?
No.
No.
Of course not. If you do, there will be problems. Okay? Okay, you just heard my wife, there will be bloodshed. Okay, so would you date someone else's spouse? The answer is no. Okay. Why would you not date someone else's spouse? Why would you not do this? Why would you not do it? Aside from bloodshed. Because you don't want any issues, right? If you don't have any intentions towards someone else's spouse, why would you do it? Okay? Next, would you spend exclusive time with your friend's husband or wife? How would you guys feel if, picture this, and I know this is gonna sound scary, but picture this, if I texted one of the ladies and said, hey, let's have coffee. Without Rainy. Okay, you're all looking at Rainy now, you know? But how would you, if you're the lady, and I texted you, hey, let's have coffee, and then you ask, oh, you're not the lady? No, just the two of us. The first thing you will do is chat with Leonard and Freddie, right? Exactly. If you saw me and another lady sitting in a coffee shop, sipping coffee together without Rainy, what's the first thing in your head?
Church discipline.
Right? Church discipline right there, yeah. I'm glad you said that. So, if you're single, treat the other singles the same way. If your intentions are pure anyway, then you would not have any inclination to want to date someone exclusively if your intentions are pure. Because you don't want other people to begin thinking, huh, what's up with that? Diba? Would you be touchy, playful, flirty with another person's spouse? Would you intentionally be charming? Hey, you know? That's dangerous, okay? Would you risk Here's another question. Would you risk misleading yourself, the other person, or the public about your relationships? It could be as simple as a harmless selfie. Because a harmless selfie, couple selfie, is not harmless. Oh, we're just friends. Not to the world. If the church doesn't know it, the world, if the church knows it, maybe the world does not. You know? Or, you know, if it's your cousin, tag in with my cousins. Fam bam, or whatever. You know? If it's not your cousin, just, if it's just another single, just don't do it. You know? Because it's still dangerous. It's still, questions still come up here. Maybe not for you, maybe for the other person. Maybe this other person has been thinking of you for a very long time. And then you're like, oh, it was so great to have seen you for a long time, selfie, okay, click. And then you go home, yeah, it was great to see the other person. The other person's like, when is he gonna say something? We look so good together, can he not see that? I tagged him. Okay? So, can you see how this can be dangerous, how this can be misleading? So please be careful. Now, we're not trying to be legalistic, okay? I hope you understand why we're giving you these guidelines. It's for the, for your own sake, it's for your own benefit, it's for your own health. How about this? And here's a question I want you guys to really think about. Does your actions cause his or her friends to tease you to each other or to suspect it of romantic? I'll read it again, slowly. Listen carefully. Does your actions, okay? Not the other person's. Does your actions cause his or her friends to tease you to each other or to suspect anything romantic? It might be normal, but then all her friends are saying, and you think, I don't know, I can't answer that really because we're friends, but friends, still not friends, eh, pak sure, eh, the way he's treating you. And the girl's like, bitaw no. And then the guy's like, now, if you do not have intentions, then it's just defrauding to the person. If you do have intentions, then that's manipulation. Agree? Because you want the friends to feel that way. It's a worldly thing. Diba? Get the friends. Get the friends to tease her first so that she's already, and then now you come in. Because you've set the stage. That's wrong. That's manipulation. Avoid that. So here's a guiding principle. We are one another's future groomsmen and bridesmaids, so protect each other's future marriages. I'll say it this way, and I've said it before, but I'll say it again. My very first discipler, the guy who discipled me, we had a very strong bond with the men. And he gathered all the men, and he told us this. He told us this conviction that he had, and he wanted it for all of us, and we loved it. He said, men, let's make a pact. Let's guard the hearts of the women, not just from the outside world, but from ourselves. Okay? So that, because we don't know who our future wives will be. I don't know who your future wife will be, your future wife. I have no idea. It might be someone from this church. The last thing I want is when you guys get married, we can hang out. Because me and her had an issue before. Can you picture that? So you guys should guard, we should guard one another's future marriages. So ladies, it's the same thing. Guard, be sisters to one another, real sisters. So that, because you don't know which men will marry who here. And so we should have that attitude so that once we finally get married, we can gather our friends and say, brothers, thank you. And this is what he did, by the way. My first disciple, he got married. During the reception, he asked for time to get the men, our Bible, men's Bible study, and we huddled in the back of the stage. We huddled like this, arms on each other's shoulders, and he looked at us one by one in the eyes, and he said, brothers, thank you. Now I'm married to my wife, and she has no excess packages because you guys were brothers to her, and you are real brothers to me. And then I said, I want that. I really, really want that. And that's how it should be. Let's guard one another's hearts for each other, for the sake of each other's future marriages. That's why we don't play around. We don't be childish. We don't do all these things. It's for your own good. And how wonderful when we can fellowship with one another in the future, married people just going, yeah, when we were all singles, we just honored one another. It was beautiful. What a wonderful community and culture we had. By the grace of God, of course, by bearing one another, bearing with one another, forgiving one another, loving one another, and abiding in Christ. Bearing food. Is that clear so far? Yeah? Okay. So let's take a look at some purpose, the purpose and misconceptions of courtship. Here are some misconceptions. First, misconception number one, get the girl. How many of you have thought this? The purpose of courtship is to get the girl. Yeah? Honestly. Me before, I thought that before. If you court someone, the purpose is to get her. Yeah, to woo, to get her heart. That's not the purpose of courtship. Courtship is not about getting the girl to like you. Courtship is not a biblical method to get the girl. Can I just say something? Okay, I'm going to say it because I have in mind. No? But we have some friends who talked to us about this. And they said, well, I don't want to use your style because it doesn't work. So I'm going to use my style because it works. I'm like, when you say works, what does that mean? Works meaning you got the girl? If that's what you thought courtship was all about, then you completely missed the point. Because the whole point of courtship is to honor her, not to get her. It's to honor God, honor her, honor yourself. Okay? So it's not to get the girl. Second misconception, that courtship is boring. If I go to biblical courtship, it's going to be boring. Well, number one, do you even know what biblical courtship is? They'll say, no. Then how could you say it's boring? You haven't even tried it. You don't even know about it. Secondly, it's never boring to pursue someone you admire and find attractive. Agree? As long as you admire someone, you find someone attractive, it's never boring to run after that person. You're not pursuing excitement, you're pursuing a person. So don't go into courtship for thrills. You want thrills, ride a roller coaster, watch a shark movie. Okay, but don't pursue a girl for excitement. That's not gonna work. Next, you're considering entering a new season in your life. How is that ever boring? I'm entering a new season of your life. Wow, how does it feel? Same. Huh? Then you're not really going into courtship. So it's never boring. It's actually very exciting, it's very challenging, and all that. Okay? Misconception number three is you must be 100% sure. Have you heard that? I'm only going to courtship when I'm 100% sure. Yes? That's a misconception. You don't enter into courtship because you're 100% sure that this girl is going to be your spouse. Or this guy is going to be your husband. That's not it. God does not work like a mystical, spiritual magic 8-ball. Have you ever seen a magic 8-ball?
Yes.
It's this black, big black 8-ball, and then, is she for me? Yes, no, maybe, or LOL. Yeah, is she for me? So it's not, God doesn't work that way. You don't go to the Bible, and then you open your Bible, Lord, is this person for me? And then you close your eyes, you point, and then you look, and then the verse says, I would rather that you be single. So, don't do that. But God doesn't work that way. Courtship is about stepping out in faith. The whole point of getting into courtship is so that you prayerfully find out with the person you're interested in, if you are for one another. We're going to get to that in a bit. Courtship is supposed to increase your prayer life. Okay? Can I challenge the men here? Guys, I tell you this. No matter how much you claim to like another girl. Now, like is a simple word. No matter how... If you like a girl, that's attraction. That's feelings. Diba? And it's so funny to be, oh, I really like this girl, grabe. And then I just want to know if she's holy. She looks at you, smiles, there's a dimple, small hole. Holy! It's not like that. Okay? Here's how it works. When you see someone, there's light. That's just attraction. That's just infatuation. Okay? Now, that's all normal. That's all good. That's fine. But if you have a healthy friendship, meaning you know one another because of friendship, that light should be more of love. Don't court someone because you like her. Hear it again. Don't court someone because you like her. Court someone because in the process of your friendship, you have grown to love her. You don't court someone you like, you only court someone you love. Okay? Because if you court someone you like, and you want to find out if you now love her, but oh, I did not fall in love during the courtship, so no, plan B. Then you're using the girl. Don't court someone you like, court someone you love. And I tell you this, I will never believe a man when he says, I love the girl, and yet my prayer life has not changed. My pursuit of God has not changed. My Bible reading has not changed. My intentionality to prepare for marriage has not changed. Then you don't love her. You just love the feeling you get when you're around her. It's still self-centered. Of course, someone you love, not someone you just like. If you like a person, get to know her. How? Biblical, healthy, godly friendships. And then when you begin to love, then you pursue. That makes it healthy. Then your courtship has substance. Ladies, can I ask you a question here? Now, how many of you would feel, what would you feel if you're sitting in a coffee shop, you're drinking coffee, you're reading your Bible or some really good book, and then a guy comes up to you, a total stranger, sits down and says, hi, your name is so-and-so, right? And he knows your name. You're like, yes, how do you know me? Well, I've followed you on Facebook for a year. I love you. What would you feel? Stalker, you know, guard. Right? The first thing in your mind is this coffee hot enough to use as a self-defense? Right? You'll fear. Why will you fear? Or at the most, you will not believe his declaration of love. Because he doesn't know you. You will never believe he loves you because deep down you know he doesn't know you. So if you court someone who you just like, why are you pursuing me? Because I like him, but you don't really know me. You just like your first impression of me. So there's no real substance to your pursuit of me. Right? But if you've been friends for a long time, you've been friends for, pretend with me, you've been friends for, let's say, 3 years maybe, or 2 years, or maybe 1 year, but it's a very deep friendship already. So you're good friends. And then the guy says, I know we've known each other for this amount of time, and I've observed you, I've gotten to know you, I see how you are with God, with your prayer life, your spiritual life, and I have to say, I admire you, and I've grown to have feelings for you. And these are more than friendly feelings. Would you believe him more than the coffee dude? Of course, because he knows you, you know him. There's substance to the confession of affection because of the friendship. So there's no such thing as love at first sight, okay? So misconception number four, there must be sparks. Have you heard this? There must be that fire. You know what? There shouldn't be fire because fire will burn you both, okay? So, no. All right, there's no such thing as love at first sight. Infatuation at first sight, yeah. Attraction, yes. But love at first sight, no.
Maybe I should walk by again.
I'll walk by again. So second sight, no. Next, biblical love is sober, supernatural, and sanctifying. Let me go through each one. Sober. It's not overly poetic, romantic, Romeo and Juliet style. Romeo looked at Juliet once, and then suddenly, you know, this whole crazy story happens. Well, it's not real. That's Shakespeare's imagination. So there's no such thing as love. It's sober. You think through things. Do I really know her? Is this really love or infatuation or just attraction? Is this love or puppy love? Is this a Christ-like affection or is it just a crush? Okay? It's supernatural. Meaning, has God placed a certain desire in your heart for this person? Is it sanctifying? That does this friendship cause you to become more like Christ? Or is this friendship causing you to turn away from Christ? Is it sanctifying? Please don't confuse love with attraction, infatuation, or even curiosity. You know? And curiosity is a dangerous thing because you're so curious, you want to get to know just to satisfy your curiosity. It might not be the same for the other person you're getting to know. Okay? Misconception number five, courtship is a private affair. Okay? Misconception is a private affair. We have a community. problem with that is a guy likes a girl, girl likes a guy, so they go through courtship and suddenly they have their own world. No? When everyone walks together, like, oh no, we have our own thing, we have our own thing. That's dangerous. Courtship is not a private affair. Courtship is supposed to be within a covenant community where we look into one another's lives, we speak into one another's lives, we talk to each other, we communicate things. If you say, this courtship is between me and her, why? Do you have anything to hide? If you don't have anything to hide, then get the church involved. Not in a you know, like a judge kind of way. What do you think? No, it's more of, am I treating her in any way that's not biblical? Am I appropriate with her? Do you see anything in me that might be dangerous, that might lead this friendship astray? It's not a private thing. You're not immune to sin and blind spots. That's why it's called blind spots. Okay? Don't think you're immune to sin. You're not. And the truth is, courtship is one of the most spiritually dangerous seasons of your life. And I say that as someone who's been through courtship. It's one of the most dangerous seasons of your life. Because the number one candidate to become an idol in your life is the person you're attracted to. Because a good thing ends up becoming a God thing. It's dangerous in so many different levels. There's pride, emotional idolatry, there's lust, and these can all, and many other, it's a gamut of things. When you go through courtship alone, here's what happens. When you go through courtship alone, here's what happens. No one is examining your heart. And so you're thinking, I've got me and the Holy Spirit, that's enough. And as long as I love God first, it's okay. The problem with that is you don't know if you still love God first. How can you tell? Now, what is courtship? First, it begins with a man approaching and going through the woman's father or family. This is from a poll taken from a lot of Christian leaders and pastors and elders. Okay? That is conducted under the authority of the woman's father or family or church. People should know. Now, I know that this seems foreign to a lot of us here today, but one thing, okay, Leonard has a daughter. He dotes on her, he loves her, cares for her, and you've seen how Ray is with Leonard. Okay, so, and you've seen how Leonard loves his daughter. If, let's say Ray is 18, 19, maybe 23 years old, if a guy just approaches the daughter without even asking permission from the father, and the guy's like doing all the moves, how do you think Leonard's gonna respond?
He will die.
He will die slowly, or there will be blood. I tell you, if I had a daughter and some guy, now, because here's my thoughts on this, okay? And here's the perspective. And I say this not just a guy, okay, we're married, but we don't have kids yet. But if I had a daughter, I'd probably feel the same way. Now, we're elders of the church, meaning, in a sense, for me personally, and Leonard and Freddie, we see all the ladies here as our spiritual daughters. So here we are, praying for you guys, laboring for you guys, making sure that you guys are healthy, are growing, are getting to know Jesus more, and loving God more, loving your Bibles more, and all that. And if someone comes along and distracts you from that in an unbiblical way, remember what Paul said, I'm jealous for you. That's how we feel. So before you pursue a woman, please, if the girl still has a dad, or the dad's Christian especially, talk to the dad. Ask permission, can I pursue your daughter? You feed her, you shelter her, you love her, you protect her. The least you can do as an outsider is to go to the dad and ask permission. May I pursue her? I'm not asking for marriage. I'm not asking for, you know, for just so you know, she's not pregnant, you know, just to clarify things. I love God, she loves God, I want to pursue her and I want your permission. Let the dad know. Let the girl's pastors know. Because can you imagine, the pastor's like, what's happening here? They're shepherds, they want to make sure the sheep are healthy. So please go through that, okay? And there must always be marriage in your mind as a direct goal. there's a difference between ready for marriage and readying for marriage. There's a difference between saying, I'm ready to get married now, versus, yeah, I want to get married someday in the future. I mean, who doesn't, right? So yeah, I guess, yeah. If that's your, if you're the second, you don't want a spouse. You're looking for a girlfriend, right? But if you're ready for marriage, then you're ready for courtship. If you're ready for marriage now, then you're ready for courtship now. Because you're looking for a spouse. Here's how a lady defined courtship. And again, this is still from, this is a pastor's wife, by the way. She says, different people define biblical courtship in different ways. There is no agreed definition, but here's my attempt at one. Biblical courtship is the period of time in which a man who is romantically interested in a woman pursues her in an intentional way with the hope of marrying her. That's the hope. Because you don't court someone you like, you court someone you love. The man and the woman attempt not to stir up each other's love prematurely. You get that?
Yeah.
Song of Songs. Do not arouse love until it so desires. Okay? In a prematurely. And thus, do not act like a couple or as if they belong to each other. You're still courtship, and it's as if you already have the rights to, you know, submit to me. What? You're not my husband. Okay, so. Okay. The man treats the woman as a sister in all purity. Their aim is to reach a wise decision with the help of their families and Christian community on whether they should marry or not. Whether they should marry or not. So you love this girl, you go through courtship, if she says yes, let's pray about this. You and her and the family and the Christian community pray for one another and figure things out. And they go through the whole figuring out, behaving in a way that honors God. The hope is that whether things work out or not, each person is left undamaged. Because many times in a courtship, emotions are already stirred. Words are already being used, okay? Things like, I love you, I will give you the stars and the moon. I will give you the moon even though it's still day. You know, those things, you know? These are words that are not necessary. Why? Because you are causing the person to become emotionally attached when you're not even sure yet. Because the courtship is still a season of finding out. Is that clear so far?
Yes.
So, I guess I have, 10 more minutes? So we'll just finish through this part. And then we'll open Q&A, okay? Preparing for a courtship. Ephesians chapter 4 says, as a prisoner of the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love, make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Why is that in a courtship talk? Because again, gospel truths tell us, gospel principles and truths, applying them into friendship and courtship. Courtship is based on gospel truths. Therefore, true love for others is evidenced by self-examination. Are you worthy of the calling? If you are asking someone to walk the rest of her life with you until death, are you sure that they're doing everything in your power to be worthy of the call that you're making on a girl? That's a huge call. And it's very humbling. True valuing of others is evidenced by assessing your own worth. Let me read that again. True valuing of others is evidenced by assessing your own worth. So, here are some questions. First, what standards are you using for yourself? For other people, you should man up, but for yourself, pwede na ko? Kubo? Ikaw na? Careful. Kani? If you had a daughter, would you allow her to date a man who is just like the current you? If you had a daughter, would you allow her to date a man who is just like the current you? Hard questions, huh? Hard questions. Are you mature yet fun, or are you immature and dangerous?
Mature yet fun. Fun and dangerous.
It's possible to be mature yet fun. You're mature and you're fun. You're mature in a fun, you're fun, but in a mature way, where people are not defrauded. But are you just immature and dangerous? There's a difference. There's a huge difference. Are you childish or childlike? Do you know the difference even? Childish is when you don't really care about sanctification. Childlike is when you're innocent. Are you intentional in preparing yourself for marriage? Are you intentional in saving your money? Are you intentional in looking long term, thinking of your future? Do you want to get married now or eventually? Are you looking for a girlfriend, boyfriend, or a spouse? Or worse, are you just looking for thrills? Do you see yourself rightly and accurately? In other words, are you inviting people to speak into your life? If you say, I'm ready for marriage, and anyone who tells me differently is wrong, I tell you right now, you're not ready. Because if you don't invite people to speak into your life now that you're single, I tell you, your marriage is going to crumble.
Amen.
Right? You have to be willing to have people speak into your life while you're still single, so that when you're married and your marriage is going through crazy things, you're already used to brothers wounding you for your own good. And sisters for your own good. Are you aware of the gravity if you're asking the other person? If you're a guy and you say, I like you, can you go through courtship with me? You know what you're asking the girl? Please change your whole season and your lifestyle right now to see whether you should change the rest of your life to follow me. So if you don't even know where you're headed, the girl should say no. Where are we going? I don't know. Well, in that case, no. Guys, I tell you what, it's easier for the girl in some sense, because guys, you're the one leading the relationship. So you have to know where you're headed. If you don't know where you're headed, you have no business asking the girl to go with you, because all you want is a road trip. But, and then people say, well, it's not the destination that matters, but the journey. Hi, Marco. That's wrong. You know what matters? Both. You need to know where you're headed, and you need to know, you need to make sure that the journey is pleasing to God. So, wait. So, here are those questions. What's the best way to start being intentional? For me, one of the best ways is book reading. Here are a list of books. And these are books I have personally read from cover to cover. Okay? And I read that because before I became a Christian, I had so many issues on relationships, but so I wanted to understand. These are some basics. One, Joshua Harris, A Kiss Dating Goodbye. People say so legalistic ko no. I enjoyed it. I learned a lot from this. And then there's also Boy Meets Girl, which is the sequel to I Kiss Dating Goodbye. Okay? And not even a hint is his third book about how to relate with another in a pure way. Okay, so these are good basic books for you to read, devour, intentionally study, so you get to understand courtship more. Next, by Elizabeth Elliot. And I tell you, if you read this, prepare to cry, because this will hurt you. For the women, let me be a woman. What does it mean to be a woman, to understand that? And guys, please, I know Let Me Be a Woman is about women, but men, you would benefit a lot if you read this. Now, the mark of a man is Elizabeth Elliot's letters compiled for her nephew. And because she wanted her nephew to be a godly man, she wrote a lot of letters to her nephew. And they compiled it, and this was the result. So even if you're a woman, read this. This will help you understand the kind of man you're looking for in your life. This is a good list to have. Or, well, I'm not saying you should do list keeping, but at least it gives you a clearer picture. No? And then passion and purity is how you go about it in a good, godly, pure way. So Elizabeth Elliot's trilogy, these three, is kind of like Joshua Harris's version, but on steroids. Okay? All right, so. But this has to do more with courtship. This has to do with identity for women, identity for men. Okay? Next, When God, I know it's not clear, When God Writes Your Love Story by Eric and Leslie Ludi. Leslie Ludi is the author of Set Apart Girl, okay, and she's very hardcore on being, just loving God and making sure that God is sovereign over your relationship, that you don't force things and all that. If you like Rabbi Zacharias, then you will enjoy this. I, Isaac, take thee, Rebecca. It's a very good book on courtship as well. Ravi explores the social norms today and how it affects us and changes our mindset and how we need to go back to a biblical mode. Cupidity, I know it sounds cute and funny, but I found it surprisingly helpful. These are the things, these are the do-nots. If you want a book that tells you what you should not do, here it is. The 50 stupid things people do for love. Okay, so it's a good reminder. And this I really enjoyed also. Dennis and Barbara Rainey wrote a book called Starting Your Marriage Right. This couple destroys the myths about marriage. Myth number one, marriage is about 50-50. And then they go, no. Marriage is 100% and 100%. And that equals 100% on the marriage cup, and everything overflows into how you treat one another. I'm like, whoa, this is new. So that's a very good book. If you want hardcore, John Piper wrote a really good book entitled This Momentary Marriage. He talks about how this marriage is temporary. If we're all going to die, we're all going to go to heaven. There's not going to be marriage in heaven. Well, there's one, Jesus and the church. That's it. So this is all momentary. If you want a really thick book on this, which answers it extensively, the book is this thick. I kid you not, it's this thick, and it's this thick, okay? Get this, Recovering Biblical Manhood and Womanhood, A Response to Evangelical Feminism. You can download this for free via PDF at desiringgod.org. Okay, for free. Right? So, words from the Apostle Paul. Now, we're not gonna go through all of this, but Paul says it this way. If you do marry, you have not sinned. If a betrothed woman marries, she has not sinned. Why did he say this? Paul is saying, it's gonna be tough if you marry. The world is difficult, fall, sin, all that. So it's better to not marry, he says. But if you marry, you don't sin. Okay, and then he says, it's better to marry than to burn with passion. So, and this is, the context here is, of course, physical passion, but of course, it's emotional as well, okay? He says, look at the implication. He says, if anyone thinks he's not behaving properly toward his betrothed, if his passions are strong, and it has to be, let him do as he wishes. Implication, he knows what he wants. He knows what he wants. So if you don't know what you want, you have no business pursuing a girl. Because the girl will say, what do you want? And then you'll say, I don't know. You can't define a relationship when you don't know what you want from the relationship. Right? Let him do as he wishes, as he wants. Look, let them marry, it is not a sin, but whoever is firmly established in his heart. It's clear in his heart. The convictions are set. Okay? Firmly established in his heart, being under no necessity, but having his desire under control, and has determined this in his heart. There's clarity involved. There's no tanaw lang na to, collect, jam. Okay? So that's the thing. So final warning, if it goes against the word of God, it's not the will of God. Okay? So let your courtship be biblical. This is very, you know, we've already talked about this. Don't ask for signs, please. Okay? Shanaba Lord, please give me a sign. It's not about signs. Please do not tease or matchmake. Because that's not healthy. Please don't wait passively. Focus on your sanctification. Learn, grow, be involved in ministry. Do the things that God wants you to be doing. Don't wait for 100% satisfaction in God before desiring a spouse. That's not biblical. Have you heard that? I need to be fully satisfied in God before He will give me a husband or a wife. Sounds spiritual, but it's not biblical. Can you imagine a parent telling a child, you're hungry? You want to eat? You can't have food unless you're fully satisfied in me. The kid's going to starve and die. Diba? God created us as social beings. And so, as long as God is your number one passion, then your secondary passions, all of them, will be under God's sovereignty. Please don't use love to get sex or use sex to get love or sexuality. That doesn't work. Of course, please do not fornicate, sleep together, sleep around, you know, that's, we already know this is basic. Please do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. I won't belabor this point, but in NCC, that is subject to church discipline, okay? Because being yoked with unbelievers is a direct rebellion against a command of God. And if you do that, you will pierce yourself with many griefs, I tell you. And don't go at it in isolation. You'll never win. Okay? So, okay. We talked about this earlier. Here's what we're going to do. Next week, we're going to talk more about courtship in community. And after that, we're going to discuss how to actually go into courtship. But let's open it to Q&A. Okay, lah? And the next one is part two. All right, so we will upload this, but we will not upload your questions because they can be personal. So anyone have any questions, go.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yeah.
So